Hi Bridge, a division of Recorded Books presents The 100% Solution, A Plan for Solving Climate Change by Solomon Goldstein-Rose. Read by Adam Lofbomm. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to images, pie charts, and graphs included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. I'm 26 years old, and I can't remember a time before I understood and worried about climate change. Most millennials take for granted that climate change is a serious problem that will cause devastating floods, droughts, storm damage, illnesses, and large-scale human and animal displacement in our lifetimes. And we know that if we don't reverse the current trend of greenhouse gas emissions, the effects will reach a new order of magnitude within our children's lifetimes. Solving climate change is more important for our future than tackling many other worthwhile causes. Because so many issues, poverty, disease, immigration politics, cannot improve if climate change worsens. Like most people of my generation, I want to live in a safe world and pass on a better one to my children. Throughout my life, I've asked myself what I could do to help solve climate change. This drew me to study engineering and later public policy, spurred me to run for Massachusetts state legislature right after college and get elected at age 22 on a climate-focused platform, drove me to spend thousands of hours reaching out to energy system experts, professors, startups, and fellow activists to understand the ins and outs of greenhouse gas emissions and climate change solutions, and prompted my recent shift to full-time climate change work. This book is a product of that work. Along the way, I realized that most people, including me, tend to take on pieces of the problem that seem achievable, but don't understand whether or how those pieces might contribute to a solution that addresses the full picture. Perhaps most significantly, few people take into account the importance of developing countries, which emit 2/3 of global greenhouse gases each year. Most of the specific ideas here have been written about before by other experts. The point of this book is to tie it all together into a framework that gives us a comprehensive perspective on what is needed so we can be more focused and effective in our advocacy. Despite so much amazing work done over the years, the world is still nowhere near on track to solve climate change. The problem is not only worsening, it's worsening at an accelerating pace as we continue to add greenhouse gases to the atmosphere each year. The efforts of global agreements, national and state level advocacy, and corporate promises combined have all failed to set us on a path that could add up to a complete reversal of greenhouse gas emissions in the time frame laid out by the latest science. A 100% solution. Part of our failure to act is because people haven't been totally sure what action is truly needed. For example, the school climate strike movement that youth leader Greta Thunberg is heading has repeatedly put out statements calling for policymakers to act, but not specifying what exactly they should do. Sometimes they've specifically said that it's up to the adults to figure that out. Meanwhile, legislators, who generally have equally incomplete understandings of energy and agricultural systems, push for incremental steps they see as politically viable and in the right direction, without any sense of whether those steps could possibly add up to solving the problem globally. The U.S. millennial-led Sunrise Movement and related groups have called for a World War II-scale mobilization, which is an apt analogy for the general scale needed. But within that broad vision, what exactly is needed? What constitutes enough to solve climate change? Without knowing the answer, we have no metric against which to judge political proposals or with which to guide how we direct our efforts. This book has two goals. The first is to demonstrate how much bigger we need to be thinking if we're going to actually meet the consensus goal of climate scientists and the United Nations: reducing atmospheric greenhouse gas levels by the year 2050. The second goal is to lay out a specific framework, which is both technically and politically viable, that actually does add up to a 100% solution to climate change. My hope is that, with a specific blueprint to rally around, climate movements can focus their efforts and achieve more concrete results. To be sure, small-scale actions will be necessary. Someone has to carry out every little piece of the pillars I present here. But to be confident that those efforts will add up in time, someone also has to be thinking about the comprehensive picture. That's the missing piece right now. and I hope this book will empower activists and the presidents and prime ministers they elect to be those comprehensive thinkers. This book's framework centers on 5 pillars of action that add up to a 100% solution. 1. Deploy clean electricity generation. 2. Electrify equipment that can be electrified. 3. Create synthesized carbon-neutral fuels for equipment that can't be electrified or isn't electrified by 2050. 4. Implement various non-energy shifts, especially in agriculture. 5. Make up for the remaining emissions and get to negative emissions using sequestration. This framework is compatible with various particular visions, proposals, and bills. In the United States, for example, if Democrats who support a Green New Deal win enough congressional seats and the presidency in the 2020 elections, that program would have a chance of achieving a 100% solution to climate change, so long as its specifics, when they are fleshed out, meet all the criteria of this framework. Or Republican Senator Lamar Alexander's suggestion for a new Manhattan Project, and similar proposals that might come from members of Congress, could provide a 100% solution if fleshed out to meet all the same criteria. Other proposals that presidential candidates might put forward could do the same in slightly different ways. Or perhaps the United States will fail to take sufficient action, and the president of China or a coalition of European and Asian countries will carry out the necessary projects instead. Or perhaps several political groups will propose different solutions that each add up to 100%, but come with different benefits or costs. There are more efficient and less efficient ways to get to a full solution. But what matters most is that we achieve that full solution by 2050. Despite a lot of implied and outright cynicism, it is possible to solve climate change fully by 2050. Yet, currently no proposal is on the table that specifically addresses the full scope of solutions needed, in part because there hasn't been a common frame of reference for what amounts to enough. Without key leaders taking a comprehensive view, we may not realize the need for certain tactics or the urgency of others. With a comprehensive view, the strategy becomes clearer, and we may find that the solutions to climate change that can actually add up are in fact more politically viable than the scattered actions we've attempted up to this point. Indeed, the 100% solution laid out in this framework could be accomplished without personal or lifestyle sacrifices, without slow-moving international cooperation, and without compromising global economic development. Focused on innovation and bolstered by policy wherever possible, this framework requires only the initiative of a small number of key entities to carry out the minimum required steps. Let's make it happen. Part 1. Solutions must add up. 1. The full scale of the problem. We can't half solve climate change. What does it mean to solve climate change? It is a problem that already impacts humans across the world, and it will continue to hurt today's young generations and the next few generations, as well as the planet's natural places and other species, even if we achieve the most ambitious targets ever set for solutions. So, solving the problem can't mean avoiding any impacts. We've already failed at that. But it also can't mean simply adapting to the new realities of a seriously warmed Earth, because scientists tell us that we will reach a threshold of warming in the not-too-distant future beyond which the effects will be unacceptable or impossible to adapt to. Whether disaster comes in the form of billions of people displaced by steadily rising sea levels, or in the form of the possible sudden tipping points that could alter climate systems in some or all of the globe even more dramatically, we don't want to reach that point. Solving, therefore, means limiting impacts to the moderately severe level that we can reasonably predict and adapt to, and which might eventually go away. The interesting thing about climate change, which makes it different from most other global issues, is that we can't expect any lessening of impacts on the way to a full solution. Most social problems in the world, such as poverty or diseases, cause a certain amount of harm each year. And if we make a little progress on a given issue, it causes a little less harm the following year. Climate change is different. The impacts are caused by higher average global temperatures, which are driven by higher than average levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. reducing emissions is not enough to avoid or even reduce climate change effects. Reducing the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere is the only way to do that, which requires totally eliminating emissions and then removing some portion of the CO2 that's already in the atmosphere. We will discuss various methods for taking CO2 out of the atmosphere later on. Eventually, we can return greenhouse gas levels, and therefore temperatures, to historic averages, and be back to normal. But the time frame in which we do so is important, as solving climate change means ensuring that the maximum impacts, and any permanent changes they will cause, aren't impossible to adapt to. As temperature and impacts continue increasing until atmospheric CO2 levels start decreasing, achieving the start of that decrease sooner rather than later is key in limiting the overall consequences of climate change. For many years, political leaders and scientists worked under the rough estimate that limiting warming to at most 2 degrees Celsius would keep those overall consequences at manageable levels. Even then, some cost-benefit models suggested 3.5 degrees or other targets as the standard, and various talking heads pretended the problem didn't exist at all. More recently, as early climate change impacts have started to raise awareness of the issue, consensus about the importance of climate change has grown. In late 2018, the international scientific community, working through the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, finally quantified what the world can expect with 2 degrees of warming compared to 1.5 degrees of warming, and concluded that 1.5 degrees should absolutely be the goal. Most advocacy organizations and political leaders have now adopted rhetoric consistent with the 1.5 degree target. This book will take that goal as a given and examine how to achieve it. To do so, scientists tell us we need greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere to start declining at a significant rate by around 2050, with as few emissions as possible between now and then. The moment we switch from emissions, adding greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, to negative emissions, or sequestration, removing greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, is the moment at which impacts, perhaps delayed a few decades as temperature adjusts, start getting better rather than worse, with the promise of an eventual return to historic climate patterns. With the condition that any solutions that get us to that goal must be permanent, we'll call that turning point solving climate change. There's a lot of rhetoric about moving in the right direction on climate change. But because of its difference from other issues, impacts being caused not by each year's emissions, but by cumulative emissions until we start removing them from the atmosphere, there's not really such a thing as moving in the right direction. Climate change impacts get exponentially worse until we solve the problem 100%. That's why it is so much scarier and more urgent than other problems, especially for today's young generations who, along with our children, would see the disastrous consequences of failing to achieve a 100% solution. And that's why we must establish the time frame. A 100% solution to climate change doesn't simply mean reducing emissions a bit each year until 100 or 200 years from now the whole world is carbon neutral. By then, catastrophic climate tipping points might have already disrupted the fabric of human civilization, and intense normal impacts would certainly have caused hundreds of millions or billions of deaths. Solving climate change, a 100% solution, must mean achieving negative emissions by 2050. We can see how some strategies might be effective over the span of 100 or 200 years, but not within 30. To achieve solutions, we'll need to think in this time-based mindset. Whoa, 30 years? Can we do that? Step back for a moment. We have just acknowledged that the only way to avert the most disastrous impacts of climate change is to totally eliminate emissions and start removing CO2 from the atmosphere by 2050. That's a tall order. It's such a tall order that many people think, consciously or subconsciously, that it can't be done. And historical experience weighs heavily on activists, policymakers, engineers, and others. Those who have lived to see climate change develop to this point may understandably think, it's taken so much effort just to get pollution reduced a little, we can never make it go that much faster. Or perhaps, we've been working on this issue for so many decades and yet it's still getting worse. We're probably doomed. Or a virtuous line of thinking. We might be doomed, but I'll make sure I at least do my part and hope others do the same. Even the last of these does not commit to or contribute to actually solving the problem. Today's young people aren't looking for virtue. We're looking for results. Many people, including the most passionate activists, seem to take for granted that we won't achieve a 100% climate change solution by the 2050 deadline that scientists have given us. So, naturally, they either disengage, assuming all is hopeless or that they personally can't affect the outcome, or they turn to doing what they can. For engineers, this means making modest progress on a certain kind of solar cell or battery, for instance. For activists and policymakers, this means pursuing state-level mandates for increased percentages of renewable electricity and public charging stations for electric cars. For corporations, it means well-publicized efforts to reduce water and energy use to do our part for the environment. And for many people, it means taking shorter showers and biking instead of driving. The idea of doing what we can is dangerous when it comes to climate change, because it implicitly accepts that the maximum viable action is less than the minimum needed action. If advocates focus on what we can achieve right now, even if all of their efforts were successful, the results will fall short, as they have for many decades. Instead, we need to approach climate change from the perspective of what needs to be done. And, come hell or high water, the latter may well come literally, find a way to make it happen. This is what younger people understand, and why the movements getting new levels of attention around the world are youth movements demanding action to truly solve climate change. Millennial thinking. The daunting need for a 100% solution may be where young people's perspective is most needed. When examining a problem, older people often consider the issues in the context of their life experience, how an issue came to be, how similar issues have been addressed in the past, and so on. Young people have yet to acquire most of that perspective. Sure, we can learn from historical examples, but we can also take issues solely in the context of where they are right now and where they might go from here. Looking backward in time is often an essential contribution to solving a problem. But in the case of technology, for instance, young people's tendency to only look forward becomes particularly useful. Political rhetoric may return repeatedly to the same ideas, but technology keeps moving in one direction. No one has tried to return society to horse-drawn carriages, and legislatures around the world are learning that they'd better license and regulate new ride-sharing apps because no city is going back to traditional taxi dominance. A forward-looking perspective is all the more important when dealing with a challenge unprecedented in human history, because there is no comparable situation on which to base our thinking. In the 1970s, advocacy efforts passed policies to clean up smog in U.S. cities. The Clean Air Act took a lot of political will and regulatory enforcement, and the environmental activism and policy leadership involved was hard and slow. It involved top-down mandates and slightly burdened some companies with extra costs, and therefore it was a hard-won victory. People who lived through the decades in which smog was dramatically cleaned up might compare that effort to today's need to clean up greenhouse gas pollution. It might be easy to assume that addressing climate change will also involve a slow, mandate-based transformation over many decades, and that incremental actions are all we can hope for today, even if we know such actions won't add up in time to solve climate change. Young people look at the numbers scientists have given us our whole lives and say, "Whoa, we need to find a plan that can make this transition happen in 30 years. There's no question of whether this is likely or not given historical examples. We know that our generation's future and our children's future depend on finding a way to achieve a full solution to climate change in 30 years. We acknowledge that as the baseline and think forward. How do we make that happen? 30-year solutions. For emissions to be eliminated and sequestration to begin by 2050, various tactics will have to be employed that add up to a 100% solution. Most crucially, all tactics that we're going to rely on must be able to roll out at full scale between now and then. Tactics that would be useful but that we're not relying on in the minimum calculation of adding up to a 100% solution do not necessarily need to achieve full scale by 2050. Full scale means a tactic has been adopted everywhere we're relying on it being adopted. For example, if a mandate for capturing CO2 from the exhaust of steel factories is a tactic our strategy relies on, then that mandate must be passed in almost every country that manufactures steel, close enough to all of them that the tiny remaining steel emissions could be made up for by sequestration, which is almost always more expensive than eliminating emissions in the first place, and is therefore the last mile, not first mile, of emissions reductions. To include such a mandate in a strategy that adds up, we have to be confident that it could, in fact, be politically viable in enough countries. Likewise, relying on a particular technology, such as electric heat pumps displacing methane, natural gas, and oil for home heating, means that we must believe that it is or can become cheap enough to be adopted pretty much everywhere in 30 years. Obviously, if it is twice as expensive as the fossil fuel alternative, not many people will choose to make the switch, and not many countries will be able to garner the political will in such a short time frame to mandate it. There are several key questions for evaluating tactics and strategies that could add up to a 100% solution to climate change. Is it or can it be cheaper than, or about the same cost as, the current system? If a clean option is significantly more expensive, it is too unlikely for policy incentives or mandates to be viable in enough countries to rely on that option as part of a 100% strategy. Can it physically scale up in time? Are there enough raw materials? Can the supply chain expand rapidly enough to manufacture, distribute, etc.? Will there be a workforce to build or run or teach about it? How much land area does it require? How many people have to make a proactive choice to adopt it? A solution implemented at the governmental or wholesale level is much more likely to reach full scale in 30 years than a solution that requires every family in the world to make an individual decision. Does it require significant changes to anyone's lifestyle? While solutions that focus on behavior change may have a chance of significantly shifting consumption trends over many decades, at the global scale, these solutions won't add up in a major way in 30 years, especially when so many people have serious financial limits. Personal lifestyle changes fall in the cherry on top category of tactics to try for, but not rely on. In constructing a framework for a 100% solution, all the tactics we plan to rely on must have satisfactory answers to these questions. Most solutions must be cheaper than the current system to scale quickly. If they are significantly cheaper, they will roll out faster. A good example of this is how methane power plants rapidly replaced coal power plants in huge swaths of the United States, as fracking made methane a much cheaper fuel in the beginning of this century. Coal workers didn't like being outcompeted. Environmentalists hated fracking, and politicians promised to reverse the decline of coal, but it kept happening because methane was so cheap due to the new drilling technology. Most solutions must require no or minimal changes to people's lifestyles. A good example of how lifestyle-changing solutions can fail to be adopted, even if they have other benefits, is the case of clean cookstove deployment. A massive effort was made in the last two decades to give families in developing countries electric or propane cookstoves that don't pollute their homes or cause burns. Follow-up studies found that many families in India continued using their old, more dangerous wood-based cooking equipment because of its cultural and traditional value, ignoring the healthier and cleaner stoves they were given. Current rhetoric doesn't add up. We need a framework to guide activism and policy efforts, one that actually adds up to a 100% solution: negative emissions by 2050. So far, political discourse has been filled with incrementalist steps. For example, improving car engine efficiency, or with rhetoric that focuses too narrowly on one tactic or set of tactics without concern for the comprehensive picture. For example, leave fossil fuels in the ground, or mandate 100% renewable electricity. Youth movements such as the school climate strike have recently raised climate change much higher on the political agenda, and they have highlighted the urgency and scale in a way no one else has been able to. But these movements still don't have a specific plan or proposal that would achieve a 100% solution. The strikers demand action, and, indeed, our policy leaders should heed their call and get to work. When they do, we will need to have a rubric by which to judge whether policy actions are significant enough. In the United States, the Green New Deal was popularized by the youth-led Sunrise Movement, and its transformational aspirations, World War II scale mobilization are around the right scale. But again, it doesn't include specifics on how we're going to achieve all the aspects of this transformation. Similarly, some 2020 presidential candidates have proposed excellent ideas, but always with at least some piece missing, or without a clear commitment to the full scale of action needed. The lack of full solution-oriented proposals may represent a deeper sentiment that we don't need to analyze how things add up, but simply need to start taking actions that reduce emissions. This might come from a line that gets repeated often by climate thought leaders and has pervaded much of the activist community. We have all the technology we need. We just need political will. If that were true, then a demand to simply act would make a lot of sense, as would a policy mandate to simply stop using fossil fuels. The problem is that we don't have a lot of the technology we need. For more than half of global emissions, the theoretical technologies that may exist in a lab or demonstration project somewhere are far too expensive to roll out economically by 2050, and usually too expensive even to make policy mandates a viable option. Those technologies will all have to improve rapidly to enable a transition by 2050, and they will have to improve dramatically if the majority of the world that is poor, developing, and reliant on cheap energy is to adopt them. Indeed, the idea that political will alone can solve the problem is incredibly industrialized country-centric. 2. Global emissions, global solutions. 10% versus 100% scenarios. The dialogue about having all the technology we need and only lacking political will arose in the 1990s and early 2000s. It seems to have been Al Gore who popularized the line to emphasize that solar and other such options were viable right now, and that we could choose to adopt them if we were willing to pay a little extra now to avoid massive costs from climate change impacts later. It's a useful way to emphasize our ability to start reducing emissions. The problem is that it tends to imply we currently have the ability to simply choose to eliminate all emissions. Even in the realm most activism focuses on, electricity generation, we can see this is not true. Yes, we can choose to start replacing coal and methane, natural gas power plants, with solar and wind electricity generation. An electric utility company can build a bunch of solar farms and they'll run their methane power plants a little less. Since the early 2000s, solar installation costs have dropped enough that they might even save money, at least with the income from state and federal subsidies. Indeed, some states have driven this process along to the extent that solar now comprises about 10% of their electricity generation. So, political will can cause some percent of methane to be replaced with solar. But if we push that to 100% and shut the methane plants down entirely, we wouldn't have electricity at night. The 100% scenario isn't the same engineering-wise as the 10% scenario. A longer-sighted political argument.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.